feel like my purpose is to really want to tell people and show people that you're limitless in what you can do. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. I believe I'm limitless. I know that I can achieve what I set out to do. The two most humbling things you can do in your life is business and martial arts.
About an hour before that, I was near enough on that road. The cartel assassinated a police officer.
Shut
in
up.
His car. They shot him like 4 times.
I feel like in life, you should be putting your best attributes and skills towards something that you're going to build. And a lot of people see influencing as influencer. You're an influencer. Don't see it like that. There's content creators, like in my opinion, there's some content creators, there's some influencers. Nothing wrong with either or. They're both just very different in my opinion. I'm really wanting to move more into the entrepreneurial space and kind of have some business of my own. We are factually the most disconnected in a connected world, bro.
Yeah, that's unreal. Thank you, Tit. That's the first match I've ever had.
No, you're joking.
Yeah, I swear to God, bro. The first match I've ever had.
Dude, I'm so privileged that I gave you a match for the first time.
Well, mate, thank you for coming on, bro.
Nah, thanks for having me, bro.
I've known you for a few years now.
It's been a long time.
Yeah, it's been a long time. I remember the first time. Yeah, the first time I met you was in Leeds.
Yeah.
On the sofa in my student house.
Bro, it really was, wasn't it? We was both in a completely different position.
Oh,
like,
mate,
mentally,
so different. Yeah.
Physically. Every way, bro. Obviously,
the whole thing.
Leeds was an experience.
Yeah, man.
It was a great experience.
You were only there for like a year?
I was there for a year.
A year, yeah.
Yeah, man.
And then your journey started really after Leeds.
It started. I took my first risk, I'd say. Yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of just had that summer and bumped into my mate in Tesco. And he was like, bro, do you want to start a business together? Bearing in mind, I was living in Leeds at the time. I was like, mate, if you think I'm going to come back to Loughborough, I don't mind Loughborough, but I moved to Leeds. It's a crazy difference, bro. And I was like, I'm not going to come back to Loughborough and start a business. I'm living my best life. Got all these amazing friends. And then thought about it the whole summer, and it was the hardest summer of my life, bro. Every day, I did not enjoy my summer, just thinking, do I drop out of uni? Do I start a business? Going back and forth. It was like
a massive decision.
Massive decision, yeah. Bro. Especially when you go from a town to a city. You don't want to go back to the town. But started the business and committed and... Yeah, the business didn't work out in the end, but the journey of not working for someone else started, and that's the best journey I think I've been on, man.
And what was the business?
It was a food prep business in Loughborough. So it was me and my mate Elliot, literally like my brother to this day. Like, we started our first business at 18, and I've just been on the phone to him on the way to this podcast, bro. Like, we're just always just speaking about what's next kind of thing. And yeah, basically just creating meals in this kitchen. Setting them off to, it was like uni students, people that just went to the gym, trying to put on size, just kind of like, just making it easy for people really. Cause at the time, HelloFresh, I think it had just started. So it was a little bit of a hype, but not too much. But that's how it started, bro. And it was good. I loved it, to be fair.
And what was the biggest thing that you took away from, like, I know you said that obviously it was the having that freedom. Was that the first eye opener that you really had?
Do you know what? The biggest thing was reality, that when you want, everyone wants to work for themselves, right? Everyone wants to have a business. But if you want to have a business to have an easier life, that is not going to happen. When you work for yourself, like when I had that food prep business, I was earning not a lot and working more than I've ever worked in my whole life. Because when you work for yourself, you're not rooted in 9 to 5. You're up early hours, 6 a.m. cooking in the kitchen. You're doing deliveries till late, and after you're kind of getting everything else together. And the paycheck at the end of the month wasn't even more than if I just worked at Tesco or something. Do you know what I mean? But it was just knowing that you're doing something for yourself that is the most motivating thing ever. And I wasn't bothered about how much I was taking home. I was bothered that I was creating something for myself that is solely reliable on me.
I think that speaks volumes as well, because a lot of people can expect to kind of start a business and expect the money to come in straight away, or I think people fall in love with the idea of working for themselves and having all this money, but like at the beginning is the toughest part, when you have to build it and you have to put in those hours, like you said, and the results might not come straight away.
Yeah.
I think that kind of what makes or breaks people when they go to that step.
100%, mate, 100%. Everyone kind of, well, a lot of people have this unrealistic vision because of social media that these kids are doing amazing things, making amazing money. Like, for example, even me on Instagram, for example, you might look at some things I do and go, oh, that's cool life. He goes to these events, that's nice. But the behind the scenes of that is someone that literally is, right now, I am absolutely broke. I can't even explain it. I wake up at like, what, 6, and my brain shuts off at probably like 9:30. Like, I'm just not stopping. And the reality is that you can see online that it looks great having a business or doing these things in your life, but when you are working for yourself and doing these things, it does come at a cost. It comes with a massive sacrifice, bro.
I have to give you credit though, because you know, you've got such a good following, and there are a lot of people that have a following that don't necessarily utilize that as well. And I've always said this to you, that whenever I look at your page, I'm always like, damn, like, I need to work harder, because you do, like, you use your platform for a good reason. You know, you're always driving discipline and motivation. You're always, you know, promoting positive, healthy things. And, you know, like you said, it may not look pretty all the time, but as someone that can just see what you're doing, I always just look at yourself and think, man, I need to work harder.
I appreciate it, bro. Do you know, if I didn't kind of try and motivate people, I don't think I'd be enjoying it, mate, because at the end of the day, throughout anything, purpose is the main reason. It's the main driving force. You know what I mean? Like, no matter how hard you want to be successful, if your purpose, if you don't know your purpose, then what is there to even go off? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And when I get a message on Instagram and it's like, oh bro, I appreciate this advice, like, that really helped for me, okay, cool, let me push a bit harder for a bit longer. Maybe I come to a point again where I'm like, I'm demotivated, I'm tired, I can't be bothered to post, I can't bother to create content. And then I get another message saying, bro, really appreciate this workout thing. Again, okay, let's keep pushing. And I feel like for me, the purpose is the most important thing, bro. And I feel like my purpose is to really want to tell people and show people that you're limitless in what you can do. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. I believe I'm limitless. I know that I can achieve what I set out to do. If I choose to achieve something, it might take time, but I know I can do it. And everyone should have that mentality. I don't see, like, it's easy to not, because we're closed in our own mind, but we can all do it, bro. I just want to get that out there.
Where do you think that mindset came from with you?
That's a good question. Yeah. That's a really good question. I think genuinely in my head, not having like another choice. I think for me, you can only, I feel like when you don't actually have a lot, you can't really, like, you can't turn back on that. Do you know what I mean? So you can only go forwards on that. And for me, I just see things as, okay, all right, so you start out in life with maybe not a lot to your name. You start off just as nothing, right? And how far can you push yourself? How far can you propel yourself? And through every step, you kind of just keep on chasing like the newer version of where you want to go to. And the biggest thing, yeah, confidence is something that you build from proving to yourself you've done something. Do you know what I mean? So throughout my life, I've kind of like get myself more confidence by saying, I'm going to do this and I'll do it. Do this and I'll do it. And I think for me, that's it, bro. Just building confidence within myself.
What was it like growing up in Loughborough?
I had a nice childhood, man. It was really nice. It's a small town.
Yeah.
Loughborough is like a really nice small town. And like when I go back to Loughborough now, I love it, bro. I love it more than I did when I lived there. But nice to grow up with me, my mum, my sister. Really amazing upbringing in terms of like, because it was just the three of us. We were just so connected, so close. Like my mum's like my best mate, I swear. Like she had
amazing.
Me. Yeah, honestly, bro. Like she had me and my sister when she was really young. So even the age gap between me and my mum, it's not like a massive generational gap. She gets me. She understands me. And same with her. So I got a lot of respect for her. And yeah, I love my childhood, bro. It was great.
Yeah, I think one thing again that's evident is like you clearly show on your presence how much you give back to your family, and you kind of pay homage to, like you said, you might not have had a lot growing up, but that's been your driving force to achieve more and to kind of look for more success. But you like, I think there's a lot of misconception, I guess, with a lot of, say, I don't even like to use the word, but influencers and the way they use their platform and what they do and how they spend their money. And I just think it's refreshing to see someone like you with your platform, man. And I just think when you see the work that you put in, and then, you know, you're not showing off, oh, I've got a new Rolex, I'm showing off that I'm helping my family, I'm taking them out, I'm treating them. And it's just refreshing to see, because you don't really see that, I don't think, on social media. I think social media nowadays is just full of people trying to impress others with a lot of, I forget the word, but...
Like materialistic things.
Materialistic, yeah, exactly, it. Yeah. So it's just nice to see that there's someone out there that isn't trying to, you know... dumb down the minds of a lot of people that look up to them. Because there's a lot of people that don't realize that, you know, they've got a following, and not like there's necessarily a responsibility, because no one, you know what I mean, the responsibility is to yourself and your family, but you realize that you have an audience that could benefit from what you're doing.
100%, bro. And like, I really like what you're on about with, okay, maybe give back to my family. You get people that stunt, things like this. Do you know the biggest question you can ask yourself And I ask myself this all the time because I used to make the wrong decision. Who am I doing this for? What am I buying this for? Who am I doing this for? In when I was 22 and I was like modeling and I was actually doing good, I opened a Monzo pot for a Rolex. The pot's still there. It's still got the initial 50 quid in that I put in it, yeah. And like, I started it and I was like, yeah, let me get a Rolex, you know. And then I remember just thinking like, what am I doing this for, bro? Like, what am I actually doing this for? Like, I haven't touched the pot again because I'm like, what's that going to do? Is it even for me? Like, am I buying this for me? Because really, like, materialistic things, you can get so much more, bro. You can give back. You can have experiences. So for me, what I like to do with, like, when I work hard and I get rewarded for it, I like to do it on things that I know that's going to hold value to me and, like, at the end of my life or at the end of a year when I reflect on it and go, wow, I really spent that and I took this person away, or I was able to do this for my mum or this for my sister. Or like, for me, it's like, you want to hold value in things and you can't do things for the wrong reasons, because a lot of people do, especially online. It's like a stunt, really.
Well, memories last a lot longer, bro, of course. 100%. And like you said, everything's so fake on social media. You don't even know. I mean, most of the people that probably are stunning these Rolexes or these flashy cars probably all got them on finance, probably don't even know them properly.
You got to take everything with a pinch of salt, mate. 100%.
So I'll just take things back just a little step. So we're in Leeds.
And I almost smile when I hear Leeds because it was fun.
Amazing place, man. Yeah. I honestly had the greatest times. I've met the best people. I mean, the party scene was insane.
It was insane.
But you were smart in getting out at the same time, because I think you probably saw what I saw in the fact that you can get trapped in that lifestyle very, very easily. Yeah, did you find it hard to leave, or was it?
Bro, it was to this day probably the hardest decision I've had to make. Just because, like, you're trapped in an unrealistic world where the priority is having fun. Okay, it's education, but
not really.
If you was in my friendship group in Leeds, you'll know that, okay, we got our education, but majority of the time we were having fun, and a lot of it, mate. And like, to be honest, it's so hard to walk away from that. Do you know what I mean? It's not even a devil on your shoulder, bro. It's realistically, I'm having the greatest time of my life at the time. Do I walk away? And yeah, it was probably the hardest decision, bro, because it is a great city and I still love Leeds. And the mates I actually met there, they were great people as well. Do you know what I mean? I keep in contact with some of them, yourself, bro. Like, do you know what I mean? So yeah, but some things you can't let go of. Do you know what I mean?
I've always said this, I think everything has a time and a place, doesn't it?
Yeah, 100%.
And the fun is great whilst it lasts, but at some point you have to realize, okay, well, this is going to end. And you don't want to end up like that, like some people that are like in their late 20s. Like, I remember like hearing of people like 28, like still knocking about in Headley.
Bro, that's
like, you can't be doing that. You can't be doing that. You have to outgrow.
I'm not here to judge, but you can't be doing that.
No, of course. but like I said, the time in Leeds, like, definitely shaped me as a person. It was the first 100%. Place I left. It was the first place I moved out of home. I learned all my ups and downs there, all my struggles. So it's forever a place that will hold a special place.
You was
the
interesting
place.
One in Leeds.
Oh, man.
You was the interesting one. You could see that you were different, though. Do you know what I mean? Like, I remember, like, first chatting to you, and I was like, oh, what are you saying, bro? Where are you from? You was like, Malta. I was like, what are you on about? Bro, what are you on about? What is this guy? And like, I feel like you always kind of had, we all shown this face, didn't we? Which was, let's have fun, let's get it, let's just go and go mental, do you know what I mean? But some people had a little bit, there was more depth towards it, and you definitely had that, bro. You always have, which is nice. And it's nice now, 5 years on. Obviously, I've moved to London, like 100 miles away from home. You've moved to London, like far for you. And now we're just reconnecting on the basis. And like, that just goes to show, bro, like, the universe has a thing of bringing people together that are aligned. And right then, we probably first met each other and thought, probably going to knock around with this kid for a few years. Not really going to speak. Now I speak to you probably once every other week. We live in the same city. It's great, bro.
It's mad. It's mad how far, like, we've both come. Like,
yeah,
and also, like, I say that, but we've also still got, like, a long way still to go. I think we can both say
just
that, like, yeah, just the start, 100%. Mate, this match is unreal, by the way. I keep on, like, I don't want to take too many big sips. I want it to last long.
It's good stuff, bro, honestly. Don't know about matcha. You need to get on it, man.
I know. I think you've converted me.
Bro, trust me. I hope so.
So, you leave Leeds. You've started your own business.
Yeah.
And then your modeling career takes off. Now, from my perspective, from what I remember, it was there was a Sun report that came out that you were going to be on Love Island.
You got a good memory, though.
I remember that, and then I kind of remember from that, it kind of all exploding from there.
Yeah, mate.
What happened?
So I'm in Loughborough now, starting the business with my mate, and then got a message from my agency basically saying, okay, we think you got an opportunity with modeling. Then I went up to London for a casting with ASOS, and I landed my first big client. So I was working in my business, then shooting at ASOS, like going up quite a lot. It was getting to the point where it was just really interfering with the business. Next big decision, do I start modeling properly and stop my business, or do I just commit and go double down on my business? And modeling's got a short shelf life, do you know what I mean? So I have to take that step and realize that modeling's gonna pay me really good right now. And I don't know if I'm gonna be earning. Thing is, with modeling, it's good money and it's really easy money. Like, I'm not gonna be here to say modeling's a graft. It's genuinely not. You get to meet great people and you are putting on clothes. Do you know what I mean? It's kind of a blessed thing to step into. So I was like, I have to take this opportunity. My business partner understood, and that's why I was still great now. But yeah, took the dive to move to London. Scariest thing I've done. Had like 800 quid and rent in London. You know what London rent is, isn't it? So I was like, let me just dive in, move down. And yeah, bro, then I just moved to London and things just started going from there. But it was hard when I first moved down, I'm not gonna lie. It's pretty lonely, to be honest, mate. Big city, bro. And modeling is probably one of the loneliest jobs I've done. Like, I've come down here, see your office, and you've got 30 chairs there. Do you know what I mean? Okay, perception you're gonna have of modeling is, God, like, you fly around, you do this, you do that. You go to a shoot, you meet people, and then you know you're not gonna see them again for I don't know how long, unless it's a regular client. So there's me going to a shoot, coming home, not really being able to see the same people every day. So it's quite a lonely thing at the start, but it was amazing being in London, bro. It was a dream for me. Like, even though I was staying in the room that I was staying in, they weren't allowed to let it out on spare room because it was so small. It was like a bloody storage cupboard, you know what I mean? But the fact that I was just in this city, I was like, this is the start. Let's see where I can take this. I'm just gonna stay in London and just make this happen, you know what I mean? And then, yeah, bro, that was the first year and it was crazy first year.
But you took the risk.
Took the risk, bro.
And that's what it's all about.
I think so, 100%. Yeah. I think it's the best thing you can do.
You honestly have to be willing to fail. I think I've always said this. I mean, any person that I've ever like listened up to, like, you know, the Joe Rogans and even fighters, and they all say, if you're not willing to go for it, you're not going to get the reward. Because if you just stick complacent without actually testing yourself, then you're never going to find out.
Bro, 100%. If you don't test yourself, then you're just going to be within your own perception of your own limits. You've got to throw yourself out the limits and be like, let me throw myself in the deep end. If I drown, I can get back out and I can just recoup myself. Or you can get in the deep end and you can just be like thriving. You can take yourself somewhere where you didn't even know you could possibly go. Do you know what I mean? So I think that's what you got to do, bro. You got to take these big jumps in your life. Like, now I get so scared to take these jumps, and I think it's as you get older, I don't know. When you're younger, you're a bit more like, just tell you what it is, when you're younger, you've got less to lose, you know what I mean? As you get older, you've got more, you're more into your career, more of a reputation. So it's like, do I take another big risk? And I always still say to myself, like, okay, you've took risks throughout your whole life, you're doing good, you're not where you want to be, but you need to keep taking these risks, you know what I mean? It's something that you've always got to do.
Well, I think if you don't have that like butterfly feeling in your stomach when you're doing something new, then I think that's kind of what makes like the job kind of so special. Because if you don't feel those nerves and you don't feel like, oh, it's a big risk, then
yeah,
it's not going to feel the same. I think 100%. You kind of need that.
You need it, mate. You really do. It's horrible. It's like the best and worst feeling, isn't it? Like, just starting something out and knowing that you could fail. Let me just not do it. Let me just not start, let me not fail, and let me be comfortable, and let me just like snuggle up and just be where I am. Okay, do that. Where are you gonna be? In the same position, on the same sofa, warm and cozy, while the other person is out there in the jungle doing their thing, just risking it all, but getting it all at the same time, bro. I wanna be the person that's kind of just gonna keep throwing myself out there.
Well, I think you've always got to think there's always someone out there that's working as hard as you, if not harder than you, to be in the position that you're in.
Yeah.
Not maybe not the exact position, but like they'll want to have a position similar. So you've always got to kind of think there's almost a target on your back, even though there probably isn't. But I think it's just good to just think, oh well, no, don't get complacent, you know?
Yeah, 100%. I think like in every industry now, a lot of industries like are very saturated, you know what I mean? And you don't want to be wallpaper. Wallpaper is just a term where it's like, you want to just be the same thing that just blends into the background. In order to be different, it takes, okay, used to have different concepts, different ideas in any industry, whether it's marketing, whether it's social media, whether it's business, you need to bring something new to the table, and also consistency. And if you don't have them two things, then you are going to be wallpaper, you're going to fade out, and it's exhausting having them two things, you know what I mean? But I think it's something that you just need to double down on, bro. Be creative, think of new things, be consistent. It's tough, but that's I think the only way.
Well, I think your like level of dedication and discipline, again, is, I mean, we were speaking before about discipline, like I wonder where that comes from in the human mind, because like I've been struggling recently knowing that my discipline's been shit, if I'm honest.
How?
Well, I just like, I know that I need to be getting things done, but for some reason I'm just still, I don't know whether I just put too much pressure on myself.
Yeah.
And maybe it just all gets a bit overwhelming when I think, oh, well, I've got to be waking up at this time. I've got to be doing this. And when I'm doing this, I've got to be doing this and this and this as well. And then I've also got to be putting in this amount of effort into work. And then I've also got to be, I think that's where I kind of fall out of place, where I just try and put too much and then just don't do any of it.
Oh, mate, it's such a real thing. It's the biggest thing, where you put so much on your plate that you freeze and you paralyze because it's so overwhelming that you might as well not. No point moving right now because this is just too much, you know what I mean? But you know the thing that I've started to do, yeah? Instead of always saying to myself, all right, I'm going to get up tomorrow at 6 a.m. because then I can get more stuff done in the day, for example. Question, okay, what if I don't? If I don't get up, is someone else going to get up and smash their day and be ahead of me? If I don't get up, am I not going to get that done? And what could that do? You are such a person, bro, that should recognize the effect of how one thing leads onto another. You was telling me a story, right, about when you waited outside for is it Eddie Hearn?
Dana White.
That's it. You waited outside for him, and like you've just shown right there that you doing that one action, you don't know where that's going to take you. And I'm sure it is going to take you more places. Like, one person you meet can lead onto one thing. You was telling me that you was trading in this bloody warehouse in Liverpool, right? And then you ended up going to Brazil, leading off that, right? Like, you got to understand, that you dedicating yourself to just going to the gym, starting Muay Thai, doing these things that led on to you then going to the bloody craziest areas in Brazil and doing a documentary. Like, so question yourself, okay, what if I don't get up? What opportunities am I going to miss? And I think that's a good mentality to have, bro. What can lead on to all these things? Because every single task, that you're probably skipping seems so small, but the butterfly effect of it can be so big. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, you're right, man. You're right. I just need to stop being a...
Just understand, bro, that like, these little tasks aren't so little, really, because they can lead on to massive things. But also just, for me, I'm trying to plan my day to...
I think one thing that I've realized, I think... there's such a power in waking up at 5 and 6 a.m. every morning. Those extra hours you get before the day starts. I think that's my challenge. It's just like, I've always been someone that stays up until like 1 or 2 a.m.
Yeah.
Easy. So I'm probably a bit knocked. I mean, I'm clearly making excuses here. Don't get me wrong. But I need to change that. And I want to be an early riser.
Yeah,
get so much more done.
You can, bro.
And 100%. It sets the tone of the day.
It does, mate. The amount of, like, for example, when me and you were trained in the morning, we've met nice and early at like 6, and we get to 7:30 and we've trained already. Bro, you step into the day with different attitude. Do you know what I mean? Like, you step into the day with different mentality. And I think that's the main benefit for me. Just knowing that, like, okay, by 9 a.m. I've worked out, I've had good nutrients in my body, and now I'm miles ahead of probably anyone trying to compete with me. Do you know what I mean? I think it's just a good mentality to have, bro.
100%.
And the bedtime, go to sleep at a certain time, I think that's harder than getting up early, because like, you're cozy, you're on the sofa.
Watching stuff.
Like,
so
mate,
easily done.
Yeah, bro, it's a waste of time sometimes, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? You kind of just need to have that discipline sometimes. And I struggle myself.
One day I'll get there.
You'll get there, bro.
So Muay Thai, man.
Yeah, man, loving it. Yeah. Oh, you see my smile, bro. I'm loving it.
Yeah, mate, you're sick as well. Like, no, someone that's done it for only 2 years.
Nah, man, do you know what? I'm obsessed, bro. I'm obsessed. It started from listening to one podcast, and it said the two most humbling things you can do in your life is business and martial arts. And I was like, let me just try and just see Wagwan, see how this goes. Did a session, I was like, mate, I love it. Honestly, it's the best thing. I think it's the best thing that I've started for forever, mate, I swear. Literally going to Thailand next week for 3 weeks. Going to be training out there.
Are you going Bangtao?
Yeah, I'm going Bangtao.
Come on.
I was clueless, bro. You told me a gym, I booked it. I was like, I trust your judgment. Do you know what I mean?
Mate, Bangtao is literally the best gym in Thailand at the moment.
Yeah, it looks
unreal.
It looks fast, bro.
Like all UFC world champions all there, like Muay Thai, MMA, it's all there. It seems like just, oh man, I'm figuring out a way to go to Thailand this year. I think we're potentially filming a pilot for a series idea that I'm directing, nice, which I'll tell you about off camera. But yeah. I think that could happen this year, which means we could go to Thailand.
That's sick, bro. Honestly, man, like have you been Asia?
Never been Asia. No,
man.
You've traveled all over.
Asia is like
unreal.
Southeast Asia, bro. Oh man, it's just my spot. My goal is to move there in January. Like I really want to just, it's just such a good way of living, bro. The people are so nice and like, it's just amazing, mate.
Whereabouts in Asia?
Where I've been to.
No, where do you want to move to?
Where I want to move to. I want to move to Bali. And like, it seems a little bit generic because so many people say they want to move to Bali now. But a few years ago, I went there for like a holiday and then I loved it so much. A few months later, I was like, let me go for 6 weeks and just see how I can work out there just to trial it. Do you know what I mean? And the 6 weeks, bro, I have to say, I've never been so happy. Like, I've just never been so happy. For me, happiness is about having like a good lifestyle. Do you know what I mean? If you've got a good lifestyle, bro, you're going to be happy. And when I compare my lifestyle here to over there, it's much better over there, to be honest, mate.
Night and day.
Night and day, mate, honestly.
I mean, the one thing that I took from Brazil in 2 weeks of just being in the Amazon rainforest was the freshness of the food.
Yes, bro.
It's off
It's a big
charts.
Thing, isn't it? The food's a big thing. How was it in Brazil? Oh, it's a bucket list, man.
Unreal. I mean, it's crazy. So they had like loads of, like everywhere was open for food until like 6 a.m.
That's mad. It's like Vietnam, yeah.
Yeah, but like, and like they would look like if you saw how it looked in the UK, you'd think, wow, that looks like a really crappy takeaway place.
Yeah.
And like you'll have this burger that has got the freshest lettuce, the freshest tomato. Now, I like salad on a burger, of course, but like some places I feel like when it's cheap salad, I'm not really a fan of it.
Yeah, no.
Whereas never tasted lettuce and tomatoes like it. It was unreal. And the fruit.
Yeah.
The smoothies.
Oh, mate, I cannot imagine how Brazil was, mate. It looked so real, bro. You went to probably the most untouristy part of Brazil I've ever seen in my life. What do they call it there?
I went to Manaus.
Manaus, yeah.
But I stayed in the favelas, which were called Alvorada.
Damn.
And yeah, completely rough. I mean, I was the gringo everywhere I went. I embraced it was fun. Yeah.
I see the videos, bro. It looks, just the view on the bike, like it looks, went deep, bro.
Oh, do you know what? That video on the bike is funny because I was holding on for dear life. I was literally like flip-flops, essentially no t-shirt.
Yeah, bro.
Driving around, like holding on the back, like, oh, please don't fall off. But it was mad, like, so, I mean, completely dangerous area, but I was with my friend Eric, who was from the area, like his family well respected. So I was never, I mean, maybe I was a bit naive, but I never felt like I was in danger. I had my, like, I was streetwise, like I knew not to be silly. But 2 hours before we left for the airport, like one road away from where we were staying, bear in mind, I walked pretty much the road next to it. About an hour before that, I was near enough on that road. The cartel assassinated a police officer his car. They shot him like 4 times.
Bro.
And we walked to the crime scene and you saw everyone on the streets just walking. Like everyone was around the car. And the maddest thing was, like everyone was emotionless.
What?
Like it was just another day.
Another Wednesday. That is mad.
Crazy.
That is mad, bro. But don't you think when you go to these areas in the world that you just, your mind just goes, oh, so there's all this as well.
Oh, yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like, I thought that this was it. Like, the Western world was it. When you go to places like that that are so far-fetched, your mind just goes like, how did I not understand this actually existed kind of thing? You see it on TV. You see these kind of like different lifestyles and things like that. But bro, I think traveling is the most important thing, mate.
100%.
Because it opens your perspective.
Of course. And even when you see it on TV, like you can get, the TV can almost give you a different idea of what to expect. Whereas when you go to these places, everyone's the friendliest they've ever been. No matter where you are, like, mate, these places in Brazil, these guys had no windows in their houses and they were the happiest people.
Yeah, man. Says a lot, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It really does. When I was in Kenya, we went to this tribe. So these tribal people, they, I forgot what the tribe's called, but they essentially just live in these huts. They're houses that are actually made out of like the earth, basically.
And mud houses, aren't they? They're kind of like mud houses.
Yeah, exactly, bro. Exactly. I don't want to say mud. It is mud, isn't it?
Yeah.
So they literally eat. They offered me a glass of this drink. And I was like, looks funny. What's that? And I was like, oh, just what we have for breakfast. Well, they don't eat breakfast. Instead, they have this drink. I was like, what is it? They was like, oh, it's goat's blood and milk. And I'm like, bro, that is obviously, wow. Like, do you know what I mean? Bear in mind, I'm a pescatarian. I don't even eat meat, you know what I mean? But my mind was just like, this is just a completely different way of life. And I have so much respect that there's all these different ways of living. And these tribal people, like, they were the happiest people I've met. I swear to God, it was insane, bro. And like, I think we need some, in the UK, in Western world, probably the same in America, a lot of our happiness relies on like validation, social media, like materialistic things. Like, we get our happiness from this. It's a real thing. Over there, they don't even have a clue about that. Their happiness relies on socializing, which is how our happiness used to rely on back in the day. And I think we need to take some of that tradition and put it back here. Because when you're saying you went to Brazil, these people didn't have no materialistic goods. They didn't even have windows, and they're happier than a lot of people here, right? And I think it just says, like, we need to grab some of that culture that people have without the materialistic things and put it back here, bro, because here it's getting twisted.
Can it even happen, mate? That's the question. Can it even happen? I think the West is almost too far from that now. Yeah. I think, like, it's like growing up in Malta, I was around like the sea and like the natural beauty, and it only took leaving to really understand how important it is to actually even just be around nature. Mm. And then when I went to Brazil, it was like, wow, like, there is genuinely something in being just surrounded by nature.
Yeah,
100%. No phones. And I think it's something that I've really thought about over the last year or two quite a lot, is saying that you're saying you want to move to Bali, is that I think when I'm in a position to do so, I would love to go live in somewhere like South America or Asia, because I just think, like you said, away from distractions, you don't have social media kind of hanging over you. The value of life is a lot better. Mm. And also, man, like, you don't need a lot of money.
Yeah, man.
You don't need a lot of money at all. And I just think, yeah, I just think those parts of the world really do open your eyes up, like you said. And I think you can find a lot more happiness in some places. Like, I love London, don't get me wrong. I've been in London for a year. I love London. For business, it's amazing.
Networking is amazing.
It's the 100%. Hub. And it kind of, without, especially, I'm still far behind you, but like, I understand that it will give me the platform to then obviously be able to have my freedoms. I understand that.
Bro.
But I think when the time is right, I will leave. Did you know you can get a 12-month visa for Thailand now?
Swear.
Through Muay Thai.
No way.
So if you have a gym that you're gonna go and train at, all they have to do is sign a paper and you'll get a 12-month visa, because it will come under like an education visa.
That is insane, bro.
Yeah.
I think the point that you're making about London's a great city, do you know what I mean? And I think for me, London is always gonna be my base for business. Like,
and
just networking, investments, things like that. I think London's going to be, UK generally is going to be amazing for that. But I think it's always good to kind of have a balance of somewhere where your heart is and you feel like you can just live a better lifestyle. Do you know what I mean? Because my heart isn't necessarily in business per se. It's in living life. Do you know what I mean? And when I talk about living life, it is being by the ocean. It is being in the amazing, like, nature-esque places like Bali, Asia, even places in Africa. Do you know what I mean? And I think, do you know what the goal is for me? The goal for me is to have like a base here, London. I've got my family, things like that. And then also just areas in the world where I've got maybe some Airbnbs and I can just hop there and just live at peace as well. Do you know what I mean? I want to live loads of different lives in my life. That's what I always said, and that's what I want to do.
Yeah, I think you'll do it, man. I really want to learn how to live off-grid, I think.
Yeah.
Like, fully off-grid.
Yeah.
Like, my brother, he's a super, like, always did scouts, loved the army. My brother's, like, well-trained to live outdoors. He's actually doing a medical degree at the moment where, I don't know the actual terminology of it, but he'll basically be qualified. Say if you're, like, in the mountains and you're, like, 3 days away from help, he can basically like look after you for 3 days medically. Like even if he has to perform surgery, he can do it. And he's going to Tanzania.
Who's your brother?
He's 21, Beppe. I don't think you've ever met him. Giuseppe, that's my younger brother, yeah. Yeah, man, he's amazing.
That is so sick, bro.
So like a goal for me is to one day like buy some land somewhere in South America or Asia. I know it's difficult to buy land in Asia. Mm. But then basically, like I'd love to have, like it was kind of my dad's plan when he was thinking about leaving and retiring, but he can't do it anymore. But to kind of have like a plot of land where you kind of have like six or seven huts the same place where you can have your friends or your family and you have like your own little community, have a little farm where you can have your own fresh fruit and vegetables. I'd love to hunt, to be honest. I'd love to learn how to hunt. I think it's an essential life skill. I just think like one day you never know where things go. So I think being able to hunt would be cool.
100%. I agree.
I mean, it's brutal. It's not easy, but I think.
To be fair, mate, I think like the whole ancestry within us, like what we used to do, I think there's still elements within it with us today. Do you know what I mean? We have this part of a brain where you're saying like, you want to hunt, you want to do these things. It's kind of just like preparation, isn't it really? You want to be prepared,
yeah.
I think. And I think it would be cool to live off your own land. I do agree.
So, you know, we've discussed about social media and how, you know, people can be obsessed with material things and how it can be very easy to kind of get swirled up into all of that. So when you were modeling, you know, face of ASOS, doing some really cool stuff with JD, did you ever feel like you were...
diving into the materialistic world? 100%, bro. God. And I look back at it now and I'm so happy that I had this phase of like materialistic things, the image, all of this. I'm so happy I went through that phase, mate, when I was like 21. Because now I'm out of it. I'm just like, okay. It's been and gone. Do you know what I mean? And it wasn't that deep. I bought some hoodies, I wanted a Rolex, I wanted these things, but I feel like it's important for everyone to go through that phase because it's all about like validation, isn't it really? Like everyone wants to feel valid in some kind of way. Is it through materialistic goods? Back then in my head, yeah. I'm gonna wear this hoodie that says Palm Angels. That must mean I'm a sick guy. Do you know what I mean? Like obviously looking back, it doesn't, but now, you want validation in different things and everyone's always going to want validation really at the end of the day. But I think it just changes. And now it's not with materialistic goods and I'm so happy it's not, bro. Didn't dive too deep into it and I'm glad I didn't, mate, really.
Do you think, I remember you saying to me that you were feeling like you wanted more of a purpose out of life than modeling. Do you think like that was kind of you were seeing all this and you were thinking, what was going through your mind when you came to the conclusion that you wanted to have more of a purpose and you were seeing how kind of the life is, if you like, of a model.
Wait, in terms of what?
Well, in terms of, like, I remember you saying that you wanted to kind of delve away from modeling because you wanted to have more of a purpose with your content. Was it like kind of the same time frame of you thinking of, you know, this is a section of what it could be like with the materialistic things and the lifestyle and then realizing you wanted more of a purpose?
Yeah, I think, to be honest, with like my whole modeling career in general, and I still do model sometimes, do you know what I mean? I think the whole thing about it was like, purpose is the biggest thing for me. And my 9-to-5 right then, because modeling is a 9-to-5 sometimes, right? It's just an undercover 9-to-5. I say it's everyone. And when I finished the end of the day, I didn't necessarily feel satisfied. Do you know what I mean? Didn't feel like I've been creative. I didn't feel like I was putting my skills to good use. And I feel like in life, you should be putting your best attributes and skills towards something that you're going to build. And I feel like with modeling, year one, year two, year three, year four, I got to year four and I was like, I'm still not putting my skills to good use. What are my skills? What can I actually start being good at? And that's where I thought, I feel like I'm a creative person. And when I'm creating content online now, I feel like I've got such a purpose. And a lot of people see influencing as influencer, you're an influencer. I don't see it like that. There's content creators, like in my opinion, there's some content creators, there's some influencers, nothing wrong with either or, they're both just very different in my opinion. So I think now I like to say that I'm a content creator because I feel like I love being creative with certain things, like certain products. If I'm working with a brand, let's say I'm working with, like last week I worked for Volvo and I had to go down to an event and they trusted me to be creative and create some content at the event. And for me, like, bro, that my purpose is being filled. My cup is being filled right now because I like to be a creative person. You're going to have me go to an event and I've got to create a reel for you guys. And that is a day's work compared to going in a studio and shooting. it's too very, like, I feel satisfied at the end of the day in one and not as much in the other. So content creation, I can get that satisfaction, really.
You've done some cool stuff. You did some stuff with Mercedes?
Yeah, so that was a trip in Saint-Tropez, which was really cool, bro. That was my girlfriend, actually. Calm's my girlfriend, just put it out there. She's a great girl. She got a job with AMG and they got me on it as well, which was really cool. So I was able to go out with them and she had to create some reels, do some bits like that. I got out there to experience the cars. It was amazing, bro. Probably one of the best ever press trips I've been on, to be fair.
Wow. I was going to ask, like, what do you think the best trip you've done working with a brand has been so far?
Oh, man, that's a good question. It has to be AMG in Saint-Tropez. That was sick. Yeah, 100%, bro. Best place I've been to, went for a shoot in Bali. It's literally just like they needed me for one day. It was in Bali. It was really cool, bro. Just got to go out there for the day. And obviously me and Calm stayed there after for like a week or two. And that was amazing as well.
Have you got a dream kind of brand?
I got a hit list. Yeah. I got a hit list. Yeah, for sure. So who's on there? So we've got Land Rover. When I was a kid, I had a toy Range Rover. And I'm just like, obviously, I'm manifesting to work with them. Do you know what I mean? It's going to happen. I'm just waiting for the right time. Bose, I really like Bose as a business. I think they're all brands that I feel like they're the top of their market in these things. You know what I mean? So Bose, headphone speakers, Sky TV was on there. I worked with them last week. So that was one hit list.
Sick.
Gone.
What did you do?
I just did a reel for them. Just what they've got on right now, which is cool. Dyson, sick brand. These are random brands, isn't it? Random brands, bro. Samsonite, good suitcases. Just like Amex. Just cool brands like that, bro. That's what I want to do. 100%.
And I know that you're a big fan of Stephen Bartlett.
Oh, mate. How'd you know that?
I was just sure you went to his talk.
Yeah.
Last week. Was it last week?
It was last week. Yeah. Yeah. To be fair, really randomly, Calm's got me some tickets to go and see him because she knows I'm obsessed. You know what I mean? It's interesting you say that, yeah, because I was thinking about this literally I was thinking about it the other day. Throughout my life, I've always kind of like, I've never had goals, but I've had role models, really. So before I started modeling, I seen a model that I really aspired to be like, and I was like, this model's doing so good. And he was like my role model in a way, my idol. And then I kind of got to position and I worked alongside him, which was amazing. And then when I started doing content creation business, I had another role model. And I was like, wow, he's doing great. And now I'm kind of working with the same brands he works as. And now my new role model is definitely someone like Stephen Bartlett, bro, because I'm really wanting to move more into the entrepreneurial space and kind of have some businesses of my own, do some investing. And like, he's definitely like great at what he does. And yeah, I think this is the next chapter for me. It's been modeling, it's been content creation, now definitely in the business world. That's like the new... That's my main goal right now, really, mate, to be honest, to start some businesses, yeah.
When did you first hear of Stephen Bartlett?
I think a good few years ago now. Good few years ago. Is he here?
And then comes Stephen. Yeah, he's a sick guy. I don't really follow him too tough, to be honest. I mean, he's got some really, really great podcasts with some good guests. I'm kind of a bit...
You're more like... Your aspiration is more Joe Rogan, would you say?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Well, I just like... I think two people I really like are people like Joe Rogan and Action Bronson.
Okay, sick.
Just because they just do. And to be honest, Casey Neistat as well.
Yeah, I love the tattoo.
Yeah, I mean, it's class. I mean, they're just people that I look at and go, they broke the mold.
Mm.
They do what they want to do. No matter if it makes sense at the time, they're kind of just following their heart.
Yeah.
And yeah, they just... You know, they're just themselves. Like, obviously the same with Steven, but those are the three guys that I probably look at and go, fighting, food, just talking on podcasts.
it's so interesting, bro. Yeah. Like, your role models, they change as you change, you know what I mean? As you start to develop and you start to grow, your role models definitely, like, reflect in that, don't they? And all them people, bro, they're creative people. They're into your hobbies. And same with me as well, and I think it's just so cool as you watch your role models change like that.
It's interesting with podcasts as well, because there's never really been a time where we've had access to people at a length that they are like podcasts. Like, I'm sure you've listened to hours upon hours of Stephen Bartlett talk, and I've listened to God knows how many hours of Joe Rogan.
Mm.
And it's like I don't know whether father figure is the right word to use.
I definitely get you.
Yeah, 100%. But it's like literally someone that has guided you through life, really.
100%, bro. They've kind of given you the tools, and that is what social media can give you. It is tools. If you want to utilize social media properly, don't scroll on Instagram, don't scroll on TikTok. If you want to utilize social media properly, don't scroll on TikTok and Instagram looking at random dog videos. Follow people that you generally aspire to be like and listen to the tools that they're giving you for free. Because you can build empires, bro, with the things that we're given nowadays. Like, we're in such an amazing part of history, really, aren't we?
It's a mad time.
It is mad, bro. If I want to go and listen to the person that invented Airbnb, I can go on Spotify and listen to everything he's got to say about starting his company. That is an insane position to be in. People need to utilize it rather than just wasting their time. 100%, bro. I mean that.
No, it's true. What you consume is really important. Like you said, it's especially when you look at your screen time and you realize, like, oh, wow, I'm spending like 5-6 hours a day sometimes on your phone. And
yeah,
what you're getting out of that.
Yeah, it's tough, man. 100%.
Mate, it's mad. Like, the generation that are coming up now, their screen time's like 10 hours plus.
Yes, man.
How insane
it
is that?
It's scary, bro.
10 hours.
It's scary. So happy with my childhood. You're the same, right?
I was going to say, yeah, we're like the last generation of, like, I remember my childhood being going outside, playing in the park, being on bikes, playing football in the street with stones as goalposts,
literally,
and like waiting for the cars to drive away so you can play football.
Yeah, literally.
Like, none of that is a thing anymore. It's just people like iPads, online. Mad.
Oh, mate. Like, when I have
no phones as well.
No phones, bro. No phone. I didn't have it. I can't remember my first phone. Oh yeah, it was a Walkman or something like that. But it did make a difference, bro. I just used it to Bluetooth music. Do you know what I mean? But nowadays, like, TikTok for kids is a massive thing, and it's so sad to see, bro, when your kid's crying and get handed an iPad. Like, when they're like 4 and they're throwing a strop and they hand them an iPad, I'm like, oh, bro, I won't give up to the temptation. I hope that I won't. Do you know what I mean? Because no way do I want my kids to be relying on that stuff, mate.
No way.
And I'm not saying, yeah, I'm not saying technology is bad. It's probably the best thing to happen, but everything in moderation. Do you know what I mean? Like, anything. Once you overuse something, it becomes too much, bro. It takes over. And that's what people do now with phones, apps, stuff like that. It's crazy.
I always wonder, like, I'd love to have been our age now, but like, in the 80s or even just even just in the 90s, just to see that last
100%,
that last generation of it. It seemed like, it's interesting, isn't it, really, with social media, because we have access to so much that it can seem like we are somewhat in the best time but then also in the worst time.
Yeah, I completely
and you agree. Never and you never actually understand, like, okay, well, what was it like? I can sit here and say, oh, I wish there was no phones, but then at the same time, there's so many more benefits to having access to social media, like I said, access to information where you can learn stuff.
Yeah, it's like a double-edged sword kind of thing, isn't it? Like, we are factually the most disconnected in a connected world, bro. We are connected.
That's such a good way to put it.
It's literally so true, isn't it? Like, I'm connected to everyone in a way, and so are you. Can follow everyone, even if you don't want me to connect to you, I can still follow you and know about your life. But put yourself outside your phone and walk down the street and go into, I don't know, a restaurant, and maybe speak to a group of people that you don't know. And we are so socially anxious and awkward compared to how we probably used to be. Do you know what I mean? Because back then, having a conversation, like when my mum was a kid, going into like a place and speaking to all these people would be a normal thing. But right now, we're just on a phone all the time. And when it comes to real life, we have this social anxiety now because we're just not used to connecting in real life. And it's such a scary thing, bro. Like, it actually is mad. It happened to me. Like, I'm quite like a confident person, but some days I have extremely anxious days, up to the point where, like, even doing simple things like engaging in the conversation at work, if there's a group of people I'm on a shoot and I'm having an anxious day, bro, I don't want to engage in conversation. I'm overthinking things, you know what I mean? And that's probably because I'm being a bit overconsumed on my phone and I'm kind of not engaging with the real world a bit more. So I think it's really important, mate, to like look up, have a conversation with someone random, and I try and do it all the time. Walked into Blank Street, got these matches today, had a proper conversation with the guy, asked how his day was going into things, because I'm like, you need to keep on practicing how to be sociable. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, you just don't see it anymore. And I feel like, as well, social media just divides people.
Yeah, it does.
Like, more divided than I've ever, remembered, speaking as if I'm like 50, but it's true. Like, I just feel like everyone's just so on edge all the time.
Yeah, 100%.
But
it's mad how you say, like, I'm speaking as if I'm like 50. Yeah, but I listened to something the other day, man, and it was basically saying that the rate of progression in our 1 year compared to back then is like 30 times. So we progress, it's like 10 to 30 times more in a year than they did back there. So we've lived in this like social media burst over the last 5 years, would you say? The progression we've had in 5 years in social media, you can say that you feel like you've witnessed it and you sound like 50 because you've witnessed so much change, bro. Like, you've seen it go from start to like calm social media, like Instagram's a thing, to Instagram's everything. Yeah. TikTok's everything, YouTube's everything, social media's everything. A lot of people, this whole place right here is for what, like student marketing or something like that. It's all for social media and it's just everything now, isn't it? Growth is crazy,
man. But like we said, man, we need the social media for our business. So it's, I mean, like I said, it just as long as it can be used in the right way, can, I mean, even like, think how amazing it is. Like, we both live away from our families. Just one button on your phone and you're speaking directly to someone. I mean, for me, in a different country, that never happened before.
Yeah, that's so true.
So
there's obviously massive benefits to it, but just utilizing the tools, man.
So Muay Thai.
Yes.
You're fighting your first fight.
Well, I was meant to fight my first fight last week and it got cancelled.
How come it got cancelled?
The interclub just fell through, which is a bit annoying because I've been training hard for it. Do you know what I mean? But I'm happy. I get to go to Thailand now, train a bit harder, come back and obviously just probably be a little bit better. Do you know what I mean? 1% better at least. But yeah, bro, honestly.
More conditioned legs.
You're horrible, man. Obviously, people don't have a clue what you're on about, but you are horrible, bro. Like, I don't get kicked in the leg because when we're sparring, we're not horrible. But when you come in, you like to kind of teach me a lesson, innit? You want me to find the dog in me, you just bash my bloody quads, bro. But I need it, to be fair. I need it. How's it going for you? How is Muay Thai?
To be honest, mate, I've stopped doing classes.
Yeah.
For the simple reason, I think the competitor in me was kind of just trying to rush my jump back into training with my injury. I've not really, like, I've done all the yoga and stuff on my back, but I know that it's still not where it needs to be. Like, I can do classes, I can train at a good level, but I just know that I need to just get my core strength up because my core strength's weak.
Yeah.
I need to get stronger all round. So I'm just trying to focus on just getting strong first and then going back. I think I'm probably going to move to South London in September.
Sick.
And move to GB Top Team, which is the best MMA gym in London.
No way.
So I think I'm just kind of saying to myself, okay, well, give myself until September to kind of get in a routine of doing strength and conditioning, getting into the routine, waking up at 6 a.m. every morning, get myself right, and then get back into fighting again. Because I want to fight again. And it's funny because I say, I've been saying to myself, I want to fight again, but I've not been doing, like, if I've been true to myself, I've been saying I want to get back in, but I've not been doing the things that I need to be doing to get back in. I'm kind of doing it half-assed, half in, which isn't the way to do it. Like, when I train well.
Yeah.
But it's just the consistency of actually doing it. So, yeah.
It's hard, man. You're very similar to me in terms of, like, you're always thinking 5 steps ahead. I want to fight when it shouldn't even be like that right now. Yeah. You should be out. I want to build up my back. I want to build up my core. You want to do it brick by brick because, like, the way that I do things as well, similar to you, I always think about the end result. I want to be a great entrepreneur. But maybe you should do it where, okay, actually, I want to just start getting to my yoga properly. I want to start working out more. I want to start building these things. Then eventually, when you do brick, 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 it seems less massive than, okay, I want to fight, because then you just get paralyzed again, don't you? But bro, step by step, 100%.
Step by step, man. I think everything comes in waves, doesn't it? I think, like you said, I mean, even like you were talking about saying, oh, I want to be an entrepreneur and all this. I do the same thing. Oh, I want to have the biggest podcast in the UK and all this sort of stuff. And I said to myself this year, I want to do 20 podcasts this year. And March, I should have essentially 6 already recorded by now. And this is the second one I'm doing in the year. So I need to be doing more, man. But I know the responsibility I have, and it's just, finding it within myself.
Responsibility and belief, bro. Do you believe you can be the biggest in the UK?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah.
That's great. That's it. That's it. If you believe it, now you just need to back it up. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Can't just say it. You got to build confidence in yourself. You're going to get confidence when you record 8 episodes by now, and not 6 or 2. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. So like, I know you can. I see your potential 100%, bro. It's just about putting things together, isn't it? That's the hardest thing.
It's the hardest thing. It's gelling. I think, obviously, I've had an unbelievable last 6 months, whatever it is, like coming and working here at Amity Studio. Mm. Best job I've ever had by a million miles. I love Ben, Connor, Jake, Tim, everyone that we work with is an amazing team. So I think also I've probably just put a lot of my time into work, just kind of get my feet, smash and work, which obviously is a massive priority for me. So I think now it's just putting the energy back. Keeping the same energy will work, and then just adding, because this is the thing I always tell myself is everyone that's successful always has it in them to do these crazy hours and to put in these reps.
Yeah, 100%.
So I know it's possible.
It is just about doing it. Sacrifice, mate.
Yeah.
Short-term sacrifice, long-term reward. That's the way that I keep saying it to myself. It's not always gonna be like this. Do you know what I mean? You're not always gonna be hustling and sacrificing, not seeing your friends. Like, I don't really socialize too much right now. Do you know what I mean? And it's just like a short-term sacrifice right now where I'm gonna live in a long-term reward. I was gonna touch wood, but I don't need to, bro. I'm just gonna make it happen. But yeah, man, I feel like that's the way that you just need to see it. You're grinding now, you can grind harder, so can I. And I've just gotta realize it's not a forever thing, do you know what I mean? We're both young, which is a really good position.
Still so young.
Honestly, bro, such a good position.
I think I'm older than you.
How old are you?
I'm 24.
You're 24?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm 24.
Yeah.
25 next week, 2 weeks.
Oh, yeah. Oh, so you're older than me, actually.
Yeah. Damn, look at me go.
Well, happy belated. But so you're going to be 25
gonna
in Thailand?
Going to be 25. No, bro. I was meant to be 25 in Thailand. I was meant to be Thailand right now, but I had to change my flight because I had a job come through that I really couldn't turn down. So, yeah, man. I had to think about my goals this year and be like, let me just move the trip and just celebrate my birthday in London. My family's going to come down. I've not seen my family on my birthday since I've been 18.
Wow.
So I've just been either at a festival or away. But now I'm like, I'm going to be here. Family, come down. Come to mine. Just chill, man. It's going to be nice.
Amazing,
it's gonna be nice,
man.
Bro.
So what's the rest of this year looking like for you? What do you want to set out to achieve?
There's a lot, man. There's so much I want to achieve this year. Set this year out in quarters, to be honest with you. Because usually I just have a list of loads of goals. But this year, I don't want to put too many cards out there. Do you know what I mean? Expose my life. But I'm going to be starting a business pretty soon. I'm starting my first product-based business. So this is the first time anyone's hearing about it, which is exciting, isn't it? But yeah, bro, I'm going to be starting that, which is really... It's going to be like I said to you before, I feel like I've got more to lose now because I don't know, I've got a platform. And when you have a platform, like, you're not just starting a business and you could fail. You're starting a business with everyone to see you fail. Do you know what I mean? But I'm not going to have that mentality. Like, I believe in what I'm about to do, which is great. So that's my main goal, bro, to start my business and really just get it moving. It's not going to be a £1 million business right away, do you know what I mean? But I've got crazy ideas for it. So yeah, bro, that's the main thing. Another goal of mine is I want to start investing into property. I want to buy 2 properties this year, which is really cool. Definitely want to start building portfolio. When I see myself as like 30, 40 or something, I see myself as a very bold-headed person with properties. Do you know what I mean? That's it, bro. Like, got my kids, got nowhere, got properties, I'm doing good. So right now, it's about building businesses, gaining some more income, investing into property, yeah. That's the main goals, bro, really. I do want to start a podcast as well, and I know we speak about it a lot.
Yeah, man. Your podcast would be sick when you do it.
Yeah, I want to do it, man. I really, really do. I just need to create the space in my diary, and when I can visually see that it fits in the Google Calendar, I'll do it, 100%. So yeah, bro, that's it really.
Yeah, man.
I'm excited, mate. I'm really
excited. Well, mate, I'm excited to see you continue doing amazing things. The launch of your product will be amazing as well, I don't doubt it. You're going to have a great time in Thailand as well.
Thank you, bro.
And thank you for coming on, man.
No, man.
It's been a few years in the making, as Josh was saying. I rang Josh before this.
No way, yeah, is
he? Yeah. He says hello.
Josh, bro. Is he still in? Where is he?
He's in Melbourne, but he's moving to London.
No way.
Yeah, he's moving, I think, like September.
That is mad, bro. I really rate Josh Hurst, mate.
Yeah, he's really, a boy.
Really, he really is a good lad, isn't he? I rate the fact that he's just dipped as well.
I think he needed it.
Yeah, he probably had the same awakening that we did. Just thought, this is fun, but let me just go out there and just see what else can happen. And he's probably there in Australia right now thinking, shit, this is insane.
What? You might, well, I don't know. When did you say you're going to Thailand? In a few weeks?
2 weeks, yeah.
2 weeks. And you might actually be in Thailand at the same time, you know.
Is he going to be in Thailand?
I'm not sure, because I think he's only got 3 or 4 weeks left in Australia.
No way.
And then I think he's going to Bali or Thailand first. He might be going back. So he might not cross paths, but.
How long is he going there for? A long time?
Like, yeah, I think so. Because then he's basically starting his travels back up, and he's going to do Bali, Thailand, Vietnam, I think, and then Dubai, and then come back in September. Damn. So
smashing,
I don't know. Yeah.
That is sick, bro. What travel plans you got going on?
Well, going to Texas.
Yeah, sick.
In like a week. For 2 weeks, which should be sick. We're going to see the total solar eclipse.
Oh yeah, sick.
And just kind of just follow our passion projects and do some sick stuff there.
Amazing, bro.
And then just want to explore new countries this year, really. I think Thailand is a goal of mine. Yeah. Whether or not it happens or not remains to be seen. But Thailand, hopefully, and just somewhere new, man. Like I'm at a point now where I just want to go to places I've never been.
Sick, bro.
I think that's all it is, and just travel as much as possible. I mean, that's one of the benefits with this job is travel all the time.
100%, bro. So that's amazing, mate. Let's set a quick goal. Yeah, before we end this podcast.
Okay.
Yeah. So obviously, I'm going to start my journey. You're going to start your journey.
Yeah.
To where we actually want to be, right?
Yeah.
Let's redo this podcast.
Yeah.
In 2 years.
Yeah.
That gives us enough time.
Let's
see where we are, bro.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll shake hands on that and say that in 2 years' time, you're going to be well into your journey to where you want to be. 2 years isn't that long time. We're not going to be there.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? But let's retouch and see how much we've progressed.
That sounds good, man. Well,
sick, bro.
Amazing, brother. Thanks for coming on.
Bro. It's been a pleasure. Love it.
Peace.